good for them, and what are the strong heroes that they can play in the current meta? It's more like they are still trying out stuff, and looks like they are not very sure about a lot of things, so we'll see.
Do you think that's like the team overall, or is there specific pieces of that machine or cogs of that machine that seem to not be quite up to tune yet with what's working? I'm throwing this more on you guys because, like I said, as much as I love EG, I didn't get to catch too much of their match, so I can't say, is it, you know, is it, I imagine, like, you look at Universe, it's like this guy will just play his same, you know, couple of heroes in this pool and it works every meta, but is it that, you know, Fear maybe isn't working with the best cores in the situation they are with the pressure? Is it PPD with the support play? Or do you think just overall EG just need a bit more time to be fully in tune and ready?
Time. They just
time,
need time.
Just time. Time and experience. Can't ask for, you know, an event like this is a better chance to get that kind of experience before the biggest stage on the planet.
Yeah, in some ways, this meta, as we get you into this draft and start to look at the pretty conventional bans and picks so far for this tournament, but EG is maybe the top team that has the most adjusting in their overall approach to do coming into this meta. EG Dota for the past couple of years has been about, you know, let's just out-efficientize you. Let's just beat you on economy. And in this meta, that approach hasn't really worked for very many teams that I've seen. You have to be able to apply pressure constantly, and EG maybe not game planning for that specifically in the past.
Well, our friend is back, Nahas.
Yeah, we have our Draskal is now not invisible anymore. We've
apologize. I went to the bathroom because they moved the timer from like 1 minute to 5, right?
Yep.
And I sat down and I was just like, I feel pretty, oh god, what's happening? And then hotel breakfast was just like, hey, you remember when you ate me? Now we have problems. And,
I don't know that was essential information.
Dude, it was actually insane. Like, I felt great, and then I felt awful within like the span of 2 seconds.
So, ravage.
Apologies for the lateness, but
we got you here now. We already talked about it a lot, the matchup EG versus Friends. We got to see interviews with the Universe and G. I guess now that we have you here, what's your take on the matchup?
I mean, obviously, EG did not have a strong showing yesterday, so I don't know if that was just...
Yeah, that's what we were saying. Is it more EG not showing up, or was it Na'Vi being red hot right now?
Well, I talked to Winter about it, and I think he and I feel very similarly that the drafting just wasn't very good when they were playing against Na'Vi.
Look at the adjustment now. They substituted the bench for the SD, so it seems like they are slowly adjusting towards what's good.
Yeah, because Venge was always the hero that EG gravitated towards. Like, PPD played that hero a lot during the last couple of patches, so I kind of understood yesterday why they were still playing it, but it is good to see, like Winter said, just them going for something a bit new age.
Well, but again, though, if you go back into meta's past, that's what really struck me about EG's drafting and discussing this team. The heroes that are good in the meta right now, in large part, they are heroes that EG has had success with in the past. I mean, Peter plays a very, very good Shadow Demon, as does Zai. Universe plays an outstanding Beastmaster. These aren't heroes that they don't know. It's more the overall playstyle and how you're approaching using the powers of those heroes at various phases.
And I remember one of the most memorable PPD games for me was a Shadow Demon game. It was like, I want to say it was like Canada Cup or something. It was along with the same game where Sumail was playing Storm and had this epic Roche Aegis steal, but Peter on the outskirts was just poison wave, poison wave, poison wave into the pit, and he had like a 6-stack and just boom, took them all out. So I'm right there with you. I mean, PPD knows this hero, and EG's been around the block long enough that they've shifted through pages of the meta and can always pull back old stuff, or, you know, they're just well-versed.
Specifically, last summer, this is something, after they won DAC, a lot of teams were trying to play EG by just focusing on Sumail super, super hard in lane, and Peter began picking Shadow Demon at, I believe it was MLG Columbus last May, in an effort to take some of that lane pressure off Sumail. So, I mean, long story short, again, they know how to run these heroes. It's more just an adjustment in the approach.
Yeah. I mean, I also feel like Peter's the kind of captain who, when he feels like he can beat something his way, he's less likely to deviate. You know, like, if he keeps picking the same thing, he's kind of just like, I can beat this with these heroes. He's just playing it wrong.
I mean, we'll just use what worked before, and we'll show you that we could still make it work.
You guys talk about Peter so much, but what about Zai? What is Zai going to play here? Like,
well, yeah, I mean, yesterday, I believe he was on the Shattered Demon at least one game.
He played next to, I think.
Yeah, that was the... They tried the super greedy support combination.
I don't know about Nyx here. It's good with bad, but it might be too greedy for the lineup to work.
No, it definitely didn't work for them yesterday. Just as a support, I think it needs too much time to come online.
Zai, Direside, Enigma. Let's just throw it all the way back.
I want to ask about the Nyx, because don't you think, like, EG Fear's not the traditional one who is like super greedy about how he plays the game. Like he's always willing to contribute in fights, and I feel like that's the kind of core that you want when you have an X on your team.
I mean, you want a core that can jungle essentially, so you can actually leave the lane to the Nyx. So.
Yeah, but what I mean is more about during the mid game when you start to see like IO relocates and whatnot, that you want your core to always be fighting.
If they're gonna do that kind of a shift, move the Nyx onto core, it's most likely gonna be Zai playing like a gritty farming Beastmaster and Universe playing.
I prefer like him on maybe a hero like Kunkka, like a greedy support like that. It's good with the with the relocate, you can X mark the relocate. Good setup with the SD disrupt.
So let's talk about the other side though. I really do like this Batrider IO open. Obviously this is something very similar to what Navi does, talking about potentially copying that Navi playstyle.
It's good in the lane, and you have those global presence later on, so good vision, good map control, good presence in laning phase, and you have safe, you have initiation. It's like a very balanced opening for the current meta.
Yeah, with the third pick, Evil Geniuses do pick up the Juggernaut, and this is most likely going to be Fear's hero. But again, the Juggernaut mid is a wrinkle that a lot of the top teams, certainly OG has shown that at Manila, putting Miracle on that hero. A number of other teams have experimented with that Juggernaut in the mid position. I don't think we've seen that from EG quite yet.
I mean, I think they certainly can, but...
I mean, when we see Sumail, I think it's Nyx Assassin, I'm sure he can do.
Much more likely Fear Jug, I think. Because I think Sumail always gets a hero that can at least go for some kind of plays. I mean, I guess you could argue that Jug does that, but Sumail's early laning phase is so good that I feel like you're wasting his potential if you put him on a hero like Jug, who pretty much just spins the creep wave and goes to runes.
At the same time, I would have said that about Miracle too, until seeing it. Seeing the amount of pressure that he was able to
generate. What's wrong
with
putting him on Juggernaut when you can always fit another core in the lineup, maybe much more beneficial for your team, and you can run like Juggernaut as your tempo control somewhat by going for like Yasha and early Yasha drums? Maybe you don't go for the Battle Fury, obviously, if you go for
I would just rather see something like Storm for Sumail. I don't want to see like him. I know what you're saying, right? Like, it's obviously very good for the team composition to be able to deviate a bit and switch up your lanes.
But this is Sumail. Give him Storm.
I don't know.
Let him do Storm things.
But they really forced the Storm Spirit into their opening draft yesterday and got so heavily punished for it.
That's true. That is very true.
Time to adjust, Draskul.
Yeah, it's time. No more blue man.
Yeah, the dreams of blue drafts are behind us now. No Venges, no Storms. Those days are gone.
I thought when I saw the Enchantress ban, they might have been thinking about something like Disruptor, because it's one of the few times where I think you could fit it, because you see both the front supports. You're not going to have to worry about that, like, crazy aggressive DJ Ench walking up to you and blasting you the whole game.
I like Disruptor. I would fear that they lack a little bit in the stun. Okay.
There you go. There is most likely going to be Sumail's hero for the mid lane.
Yeah, I like the Timber.
And we know he plays a wonderful Timber. I can't remember which tournament it was when he really started to just go ham with the Timber in that safe lane. Might have been Frankfurt Major. I can't remember exactly. Friends, though, their response, Slark.
Oh.
Remember, what was it? The Friends series yesterday.
Can we not bring that
up? We can bring it up there now.
Yeah, Aloha Dance after an 0-7-2 performance in Game 2 on Morphling just turns around and absolutely... I think he finished like 19-0-8.
Yeah, 18 or 19-0.
Oh,
it
my
was,
goodness.
It
Stuff
was
of nightmares.
Very, very good. I was going to bring it before because I wasn't sure what they were going to do to pair with the Wisp. And if Aloha are always... Always Wanna Fly always has like a candidate that he typically pairs with a Wisp, and was like, I guess Slark, but they will go for it. Last ban is going to be the Sand King by EG.
Boy, interesting. A lot of attention given to that potential ability of Sand King to punish the melee cores in that matchup, particularly in the mid lane.
Yeah, like it's very common now when you pick Timber, you ban out Sand King so that you give Timber an awesome time in the laning phase.
Or even Juggernaut, right? We saw that in the previous series, how that Sand King was able to punish the Juggernaut side of lane.
I don't know what else you get. I mean, as always with any G team, they love to save G for the end, or at least know what G's going to go against. So
Voker.
Voker. One of his classic snowball heroes in Voker. I still think Lina is pretty good against Timber, just with the burst damage potential.
That's true. You want to have a lot of spell damage against
that. They banned that Zynigma. I was hoping to see a flashback of that. Dire side. I mean, he is like the one who like came up with the staple rotation at the time.
We might see a jungle Beastmaster because it's IO and Dazzle. It's pretty defensive, so EG might be thinking of running something greedy, a jungler hero. That's why friends are thinking about Enigma.
I just think you have to be careful with that mentality because, again, you might say the same thing about Na'Vi when they pick their IO and Dazzle. Mm-hmm. It's defensive, but they don't play it defensively.
I guess that's a bit harder this time because they had Bane. Bane plus
IO. Yeah, it's true.
Bane plus IO, that game, Dazzle is much more difficult to do the same thing that Bane can offer you in the early game.
And Slark's a much weaker laner, takes a bit longer to come online than the cores that Na'Vi were running with it.
Alright, so what's the G hero here? I don't know who can go toe-to-toe against the Timber in the mid lane.
Ember, okay.
Interesting
melee
choice.
Melee.
Interesting.
They don't have much lockdown for
him. Just Beast, yeah.
Yeah, so it's a pretty good pick in that regard. The Slark and the Ember are both very slippery heroes, so they need a lockdown hero here for sure, I think.
So does that mean they will get Zai a lockdown hero and just give...
I think you can go back to the Lion Venge for PPD and put Zai on the Shadow Demon again.
I don't know about Venge though. Maybe Lion, maybe? But
yeah, Disruptor?
Venge. Okay, Venge, now that I say it, seems pretty bad.
Alright, I'm not feeling so well, boys. It's hotel breakfast round
right,
two.
Go,
apologize.
No, don't worry about it, dude.
It happens.
Dude, I will take rain until you're back. Don't worry about it, dude. Take your time.
Yeah, we can do the three-man.
It doesn't offer the direct kind of stun lockdown of a Lion, but I mean, you could go back to the Disruptor. It's very good against the Wisp, even very good against the Ember Spirit, but they're going to go with a trusty
that
Oracle.
That's not what I thought we'd
That's
see.
Not the lockdown, but it is an anti-Batrider, I guess. E.g. finding more value in that.
Wait, what?
Whoa, that can't be right.
No, that's going to be...
What you're not seeing on the screen is Sumail is currently on Oracle. I imagine this will definitely be swapped with Zai, who has yet to pick his hero, flirting over the Timber Saw. This is just mind games from E.G. But please, Lord, if somehow Sumail plays Oracle, I would definitely love that.
I mean, is that even possible?
I don't know. All right, Winder, I think you should join me until Draskel's back,
yeah,
though.
Why
I think
don't
that's how it has to work. So,
he's not swapping heroes.
He is not
what?
Swapping heroes. All right,
okay.
Can we just watch the game? This is crazy. Okay, so Sumail is playing Oracle right now, and he has a null talisman and two shared tangos. This is an EG back pocket strat, without a doubt. Oracle's potential as a solo laner. Now, you get quick levels into Purifying Flames, that nuke does a lot of damage. He has a fantastic bat, a fantastic base attack time. He can last it very well, he has a long range, and you can manipulate your opponent with Fate's Edict and prevent them from getting last hits. You don't amplify your physical damage anymore, but I don't know, man, I'm game. I am game. This is going to be a fun game number one.
Do you
one.
Get Aghanims right away?
What? On no. I,
then what do you get on Oracle?
What do you get on a farming Oracle?
Do Dagon or something? I don't know. You can do Yules. Yules combo effect with Oracle is pretty damn ridiculous. You can charge up the False Promise first, and then you can cancel it with Yules, restrike Purifying Flames,
we'll
do
just
three
wait.
Times straight.
We'll just wait and see, but overall, the reason why EG did this is because, like I said, they feel like they can get away with something greedy because opponent doesn't have very aggressive supports to punish them. So they are utilizing Beastmaster as their Iron Talon jungling hero, and with hopes that they can actually get away with it and get a 4-hero core lineup with an Oracle mid, which I'm not too sure about.
This is going to be an exciting game. I'm already looking forward to it. Draskel's missing out right now. Until he gets back and realizes that Sumail's actually playing Oracle, he's going to be like, what the hell's happening here? And it's an Oracle on a 2v1 here, so we'll have to see. But as mentioned, once he gets the levels in, he has huge burst potential with Purifying Flames.
I mean, he's got a long range and a great attack animation. He can, in theory, stand back and CS here.
Yeah. This is interesting. Like I mentioned, I mean, maybe Yules. You can then do the Q.
How about Aether Lens first?
Aether Lens is fine. I mean, you get more range to use your ult. I don't know what the intention of his ult is. I mean, if it's overthrow, Blink Dagger is great. Blink Dagger is great because, you know, you'll always be able to get a blink off to safety. Heart. You get double the regen based off your ulti. Yeah, this is going to be neat.
And Zai, the Timbersaw player, while Universe is taking the Beastmaster in with that classic Iron Talon jungle.
Yeah, so definitely a very different setup here for EG. There's no Zai to the offlane.
Feels like the Sad Boys team where Zai is always on some greedy hero.
Sad Boys team?
Yeah.
That was a nice throwback.
But he's always like playing like the Enigma, especially. I guess he doesn't play the Beastmaster, that's why they are putting Universe in the jungling Beastmaster.
Yeah, that's weird. Or maybe Zai plays Timbersaw better between him and Universe, I guess. I'm not too sure. Either way, he's caught between three right now.
He did get that early point into chain and be able to make it back in a way.
Yet again, a lot of investment rotating down by friends to try and do something to Zai.
Okay, Oracle is 7-1 to Slark's 4-1 right now. Why'd he level up? He's going more into purifying flames.
Yeah.
This is gonna be great.
You gotta be careful. Leave that top lane open.
Theoretically, this lane is so bad for Slark. Like, Slark is gonna get
bullied. You do EQ, E, Yules, EQ, E. You could do like a ridiculous amount of damage.
Sounds like you're playing Earth Spirit, you know?
Yeah, it's. If you juggle them around appropriately, you'll just do deceptive damage. What's the nuking power at level 3 Purifying Flames? Like 375, or is that level 4?
That's level 4, I think.
Yeah. It's really, really good. 360. It's 270, though, at level 3.
Yeah, EG are just getting so much out of the map right now. They're uncontested top, they're winning mid.
Friends are doing their own jungling, so with the bad rider, they're trying to, you know, get something of their own as well.
Yeah. Trying to punish Secret for not having too much in the lane. PPD rotated to the bottom. Zai's gonna be good. He's healing through with the help of his reactive armor, which he bumps up to level 2 now. And he will survive.
Yeah, this Timber is just causing a lot of chaos, but Ember is still last hitting pretty well. Only 4 behind the Jug, which has 3 lanes since the Bright Rider is all about jungling.
As we see here, No Fear does not have Grave, but he does have mana with a heal. And all the meanwhile, always want to fly. He's actually going to get the jump. They take down Sumail. Must have connected with the Pounce and some Spirits, and Oracle really had nowhere to go. And obviously without his ultimate yet, only so much he can do to survive. A self Fate's Edict and Purifying Flames will help heal you up fast, but Slark doesn't care about that, and we'll just right-click you.
Yep, not a good start for the Oracle, seems, giving up an early kill.
It's weird, it's just maybe they value in getting a support leveled up fast so they can 5-man sooner. Like, I'm still rattling my head as far as the intention of it overall.
I'm not sure of the overall strat, because basically if they wanted to just have a jungling Beastmaster,
maybe like, just Sumail disrespecting friends and saying, I'll beat you with whatever I want mid lane.
I mean, if you think about the idea of the Oracle here, he does serve a very good purpose against what friends have. You can remove the shield from the Ember, you can remove the lasso from
him again. Might not be enough, though.
But do you really need him to be a core to get all that done?
Yeah,
that's the question.
Yeah, I don't know, but
I'm really curious as to what they're going to get out of farm on that Oracle.
He got hit. He's going down.
Yeah.
There it is for sure.
For sure.
Got him there. No, he didn't get it again.
Oh my.
Finally, they get him down, and friends will be able to not avoid that. EG will be able to get themselves on the board.
Like, going back to your point, like, we are really not sure why they actually put him as a core, because as a support, he does provide somewhat almost the same benefits to the team. I think it just comes back to the fact that they just wanted to have a jungling hero, and they wanted a hero that can counteract what friends can do. So Oracle mid. I've not seen it before, so I'm not sure how is it gonna work. But I shall reserve judgment until after the game.
Pounce connection. This is probably what happened last time that we missed. Sumail goes valiantly for the TP and we'll be able to make it out. So.
I mean, don't you want a point in Fate's Edict so you can actually do that, like, safely? Fate's Edict yourself and TP out against all the spell damage.
A universe with a pretty good timing on his level 6 on that Beastmaster is going to be able to potentially go and rotate, threaten either mid or bottom with the Roar Gank.
Yeah, I guess that means he's putting more points into Fortune's End, the Q.
Yeah, 2 points.
More damage, more burst, I guess. More chances to quickly take the Wisp out.
Yeah, look at drawing on the map there.
I mean, now he does a lot of damage.
So, basically, if they can catch the Batrider jungling, that would be great for them. They're drawing a line going back towards top. I think right now for EG, getting wards down enemy jungle territory, scouting out the jungling of the Batrider would be really, really good for them if they can actually get all those deep wards down. They place one behind the tier 1 at top, and Zai here gonna get spotted out by Nokia.
Get him. Come back to Dazzle. Well, Zai says no thanks. Timber chains up and away, and he'll get zoned out, but meanwhile EG are making waves here in the top lane. It looks like a Swift tier 1 is in order for them. Meanwhile, they continue to pressure about Sumail a bit, but he's got PPD behind him. He goes right for the ulti at level 6, so he's not like, you know, holding out on it like any other support.
Good decision by EG there. They would have liked to have gotten a kill with the Roar, of course, but they'll take the tower.
Okay, they make a move for Zai. They hit him with a couple of spirits. Still Timber Chains out, but Universe is here now. Dishes out the roar, but no follow from EG yet. Suddenly Sumail appears. They'll need to get a bit more burst, but Wisp is too far out to burst him down. There, he's going to get the False Promise on to Zai. Keeps him alive, hits him with the Purifying Flame, so he'll be able to heal through. So that with the Reactive Armor, he might get near full life. Sure enough, it is almost full. No Fear also flirting around here. Both teams playing a serious game of footsie, but neither of them are able to kind of shed any serious blood. EG just really kind of being defensive in this bottom lane, not allowing friends to kind of, you know, impose too much
Yeah, we take our footsie seriously on this catch.
Yeah.
I think overall right now, game state is very good for EG since they are the team that went for a greedy start, so going unpunished 1-1 at 7 minutes is pretty good news for them, and their Timber is still getting somewhat decent levels and farm out of the offlane. Going for 3 points in reactive armor, allowing him to do that.
Yeah.
They're smoking. I don't think they have roar for quite some time, no?
But they got level 4 Purifying Flames, so here they come. 360 damage, at least
nice
twice for
that
sure.
A lot of teams use. They'll apply pressure to the bottom tower and just look to pick off any enemy hero that walks out there in response.
I'm sure that's the plan, you know, smoke with Purifying Flames. Okay, roll is back up.
Purifying Flames, Fortune's End, Purifying Flames.
They
that's
have
a
the
finger.
Ward, they have the ward down right now, so they're going to be able to scout out the jungle. So, pretty decent information to decide where they can make a move right now.
And it looks like moves are being made potentially towards top.
They just cannot kill those timbers off.
Good little sidestep. Sai is certainly being quite the machine here, not allowing any sort of easy takedown by friends.
It just feels like Zai has been in a lane with three friends heroes the entire game.
And there's
all friends heroes. Here's four.
Four
okay.
friends.
Apparently
finally.
Four is the magic number.
Four is the number to get Zai down finally. While they do that, EG make their own trade as they pressure this mid lane. They go back into work. EG, as you can see, still claim the overall net worth as they accumulate more in the economy across the map overall.
That is so similar to what DC does every time we move on Timber. Just drags up so much attention to him with the reactive armor build. Mm-hmm. And his team is like taking objectives elsewhere.
EG rotate to the top just as friends step out. And not all of Friend's TP away. I was seeing if EG wanted to rotate in from behind, but it looks like they'll hold off here. They're more focused on the task at hand, moving for these objectives, really. It's a pretty passive game overall, actually. Was that the kind of game plan for both of them?
It certainly favors EG, as we've talked about.
I mean, it feels like Friends are trying to do some work, and sometimes they get successful with the one kill on Oracle, but they try over and over again on someone like Zai, and it's not easy.
Their heroes are not meant to pressure too much early, since they have very defensive supports, and Fatrider wants to get his blink, so it's just up to Ember, maybe if he can make a move when he gets a good rune, haste rune, maybe.
Oh. Careful. Now he's healing him, though.
Okay, so he's going for Aether Lens first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's fine, but we're still not, you know.
Oh, the heal
bomb. Oh! Little Timber Chain away. He's running out. But as for the note on Oracle, though, it's like we're not seeing yet why this Oracle had to be mid.
Shatter Dance used on Slark, and they're going to try and push him back at least.
Okay. A little bit of a slowdown.
SD's coming in. SD's coming in from the side, though.
Yeah, but Zai's pulling out, so I don't know if they're on different wavelengths or
if
he's busy
greedy
with something
else. Greedy here. No.
Just a little bit of ward game here. And we touch base back at top lane. The Quiet Fear Chug. You know, while the rest of his team is getting harassed quite a bit from friends, he's been, you know, serious mode with the farming. He's currently at the top of the net worth by a decent amount, too. So the Jug continues to find his grind here. And if he decides to kind of join the rest of his team and go into fight mode. Could be a bit of trouble for friends if they're not ready. And for friends, I imagine level 6s are coming together for the support. Should they be looking to maybe set up some relocate plays here? What are
they? Oh, relocate.
Whoa. Oh man, that was close.
He has no TP.
Get him. Fear's running though. He's out. They're not going to be able to make chase. Seems to be the name of the game so far. Oh, back at bottom lane, when Always One Fly makes his return, PPD's there waiting for him, so him and Zai will be able to bring down the Wisp. Alright.
Yeah, it's a really tough Wisp game when you have a late level 6 right now. Almost all the EG heroes have a way to delay or escape outright from the from the relocate gank.
Wonderful counterplays coming out from EG, but now they're looking to take the initiative as they smoke and head up towards the top right here. Fear will spot out the slot.
Oh, that's so...
He comes to the low ground, and guess who's waiting for him?
That's
EG, but they don't have any way to stop him from Shadow Dance TP out.
But the second straight Shadow Dance that was used basically defensively.
Yeah. I don't know, was there a world in there where maybe Universe could have just done an instant roar? Would it have been worth it?
Nah, no time.
No, no time? Was it that quick, fast. Huh?
Yeah,
roar hasn't.
Kid's a cowboy. He's got a fast trigger finger, so.
Shadow Dance is instant, isn't it, Winner?
Yeah, it is. There's no way Beastmaster would have gotten the stun there unless Luck messed up.
We could have thought for a moment he was safe, casually just jumping away from the jug, but yeah, you're right. Insta-cast, EG will not get that chance, and they get back into the grindstone to farm in the meantime here. And Boots of Travel are in order soon for the Ember, but still has a bit ways to go.
How about the Batrider? Did he go for the Blink? Or did he go for some greedy build?
Drums, and yeah. He's actually making okay time for a Blink. As a follow-up though, close to 1500 gold.
Still doesn't have lasso skill to level 8, which is something that we're seeing more and more with the Drums first build on Bat.
Friends use a scan around their jungle, so they are gonna know EG's running in.
And the Slark in a bit of a dangerous spot. Okay, it looks like they'll take the safer road, and both of them will bail out as they TP away from the trouble. EG's rotation will be short-lived, as they're not gonna be able to have any targets to make the jump on. 2-2. So we get about 13 minutes in. Still pretty quiet, easy, breezy game here.
Glad to see I didn't miss anything.
Yep, Draskull's back. Welcome back, Draskull. One thing you may have missed, if you didn't see, is that Sumail is actually playing the Oracle. He played it mid lane. It wasn't like he made any sort of epic mid-game presence on the Oracle, but he got a lot of levels really fast and got Aether Lens. That's about the end of it. So I'm not sure what the game plan was there. With, you know, maybe they wanted to get a support farmed up that much faster, or that, you know, they felt like he's a good enough solo mid laner that, you know, they'll be fine with it. But
all right,
it's been interesting.
Well, as EG take the pressure off mid, take their first rush on the game.
Zai, false promise. They cancel out the lasso. We're gonna mute those other guys, and Draskull and I are gonna go ahead and take on over. Thanks, guys, for helping out. We'll see you at the conclusion of this game as we see Zai, his life will get concluded. Sumail with a double kill, though, able to snipe down a couple with the help of the Purifying Flames, and suddenly he's boosted up to about 1,500 gold.
So right. Was it the Oracle Ember matchup mid? Is that what ended up happening?
Or was it
Slark mid?
It was Slark plus Wisp versus Oracle.
Okay.
Oracle did die one time. They did manage to get the Pounce connection, and the Wisp came in with Spirit Balls, and he didn't put any value into early Fate's Edict, so he did get taken down, but that's been about it. So that was the only takedown on Sumail at the time. And top lane, PPD is laying into this Ember Spirit right now. He's just trying to farm across the map with his new Ruby shoes. But yeah, I know it's been interesting overall. I mean, he's obviously one of the more farmed Oracles you'll see in any game of Oracle at this time. Just trying to see what kind of benefits you can make out of having an Oracle this big now.
I mean, I guess one of the benefits is being able to break through Flame Guard relatively fast. Because I think it's like, what, 2 nukes and it's just gone? So when you have a super high level Oracle at this stage in the game, you can kind of abuse it in that regard. Slark and Io are pretty easily burstable as well. So maybe they're just playing around, you know, Roar, you get like double or triple nuke off with the Oracle and you can just get a quick pick. And it seems kind of weird, obviously. I have never seen an Oracle mid in a competitive game, so I'm kind of sad that I missed like the first 10 minutes, but he seems to be doing okay.
It wasn't super exciting, I'll tell you
yeah,
that.
Well, of course not.
I already talked about, you know, it's like Oracle's got a great base attack time, great last hits, you know, range, and some respectable damage, and if you're going the lane with an early Null Talisman, he'll have even better damage. So the CS game is good, and he won the CS game, you know, by a bit, but it's not like he was, like, unleashing the fury of early Purifying Flames and showing, right. Like, this is... I was hyping it up as if it could be done, and the Wisp should be careful, because if he gets, like, a three-hit combo, he'll just lose all of his life, but that didn't happen. You know, Friends probably just, you know, kind of had the idea of Oracle's potential and didn't hand over any easy opportunities, so.
You can still, like, deny all the range creeps, right?
Yeah, if you get up to at least level 3, you can insta-deny your own range creep.
Yeah. Okay, he wants that courier so bad, Jesus.
Not gonna get it, though.
He's out of there.
pulls it off. And okay, up and above, they're gonna lasso up Zai. Now another thing you miss is that they've been putting a lot of pressure on Zai throughout this game. Zai found heavy value, like we see from Mu on Digital Chaos, and leveling up the reactive armor. So he has been really a really tough cookie to crack. And for multiple ganks, they could not get Zai at all, and they were able to avoid those gank attempts. But these past two times, they've been able to get the best of Zai. They do have to commit the lasso and everything for it. But now we're getting a bit of a trade here. Tier 2 top lane.
Yeah, lasso's down, so this is a really hard question.
Yeah, EG are just ripping up the speed now while they know there's no lasso and making their approach on the bottom. And Fear, who had been pretty much delegated to farming for the most part, he's pretty stacked. He can do some work here. There's going to be the roar. They're looking to burst down Yoku. He gets the grave save, and he gets the assist from the Wisp to step on back. It looks like the Aegis will be knocked down out of Fear's hands. As he comes back, they have the chains waiting for him, but they're going to quickly give him the Fate's Edict and a Disruption, both to save him. And EG will be able to reposition here, but you know, it's only 17 minutes in. It's a small kill count of only 4-4, but already EG take down a tier 3 in the bottom lane.
Yeah, it's exploiting one of the big weaknesses. You know, when these teams don't have much catch anymore, like you're seeing like two defensive supports or, you know, an IO and a Dazzle in this case, you don't really have a whole lot to catch. And so we're going to see another reload here on Zai.
Yeah, but Zai is already far off to the left. Not able to have a TP here as it's still on cooldown. He'll just try to muscle his way out, but that ain't going to be happening. Timbersaw falls once again.
Yeah, this is another one of those games where you really want at least a hood on the Timber, because a lot of the damage you're going to be taking in the early game from friends is all magical. Like, even Slark does a fair chunk of magical damage. So going for the straight Bloodstone still, obviously a core item on the hero. Maybe it would have been better to deviate a tiny bit just to give yourself the added durability. But he's getting a lot of hate.
Boots of Travel on Oracle is the second item pickup here.
I think it's okay.
Got travel in, you can, so you can get those purifying flames off.
You can bot to the Beastmaster Hawk and roars somebody and you just blast.
The only, because that's the thing, is like when we first saw it come to lane, we're also thinking like, what is the build then on this core Oracle? The only thing I could try theorycraft is like, yeah, you get a Yules, because then you could do the cool Yules combo to cancel the purifying flame heal, and you can end up doing like four of them straight. But
Yules is really good against Ember if you didn't already have a dispel. But
yeah, he already has though the False Promise, which quickly takes out Flame Guard. Very nice, but. Nonetheless, fun little item here for the Oracle, and we'll see the adventure of Sumail continue.
Wait,
in the meantime.
False Promise actually the Q name? I thought that was the ulti name. Do I have that backwards the entire time?
No, I keep saying it backward. False Promise is the ulti, and Fortune's End is the Q.
I said
that backwards at the start of this game too, but I even play Oracle a lot, but I always mix up the Q and the R.
It looks like he's going the Aghanim's build, huh? Mott seems pretty excited about that. Either that or he just has like a tick or something.
It could be, you know, numerous other things. I mean, Oracle does benefit a lot from just fast health regen. As he False Promises himself, he gets double that regen. But I don't know, what's the benefit of the Ags is that you do Purifying Flames even faster.
It's a 1 second cooldown with a 0.1 second cast point.
Yeah.
So you just...
you cast it like 9 times straight on your ally,
yes.
And then they jump in and they have like a bazillion health regen. That's what you do.
I think the idea is you want to just kill a hero super fast.
Yeah, but that's such a huge investment just to do Purifying Flames a bit faster. I don't know if I'm sold yet or not.
I mean, I don't know if I am either. I just think that's what he's building.
I know.
Bloodstone is pretty mediocre. I mean, I guess you could get Octarine, but that doesn't seem super good either.
I definitely would love to pick the mind of PBD on this one here. Zai. We'll see if it works out for him. Aloha Dance is going to commit it in deep. Zai saved with the disruption as he regroups outside the base. Fear who being gone in pretty deep. Eats a lot of damage here, but Sumail's going to be there as the acting paramedic and does heal him up. You know, watching as well, Sumail's very defensive with his abilities. I mean, it might just be so he gets an Axe to get off more heals for his team, for God's sakes. I mean, he's got everyone up back to full now. And they will all step back and avoid the trouble here, but Aloha Dance is harping on PPD here, nipping at his heels. Decides to go for a poke on Zai in the meantime, as he hits him with the Silver Edge, I imagine.
It's really difficult for friends to stop the siege once it's already started. Like, they can linger for a long time. They have the Healing Ward, they have Oracle Regeneration as well. And, you know, if for whatever reason a Jug reaches that critical mass, you can just use the Shadow Demon Illusions to help push in the base as well. So they have a lot of ways to be able to break base, and PPD looks like he's going to be dropping here.
Yeah, it looks like he'll try self-destruction here, but
maybe
Universe
not.
Steps in. Sumail's there, helps him out with a False Promise. And with Universe's help, they're going to get the quick turnaround, taking out the Wisp here. Aloha Dance is also a man on the scene, but it looks like he'll make it back in a way, and all will be well. And you know, you're right. Unless maybe friends could find a way to build up a lot of farm, they get their Ember Spirit, all those big hard-hitting items, and then you have at least huge Sleight of Fist to help prevent the siege of EG, but in the meantime, that's not so easy.
The biggest issue is like Friends, you know, they want the chaotic fights, they want the scrappy skirmishes so you can relocate, you have a Slark, you have an Ember Spirit, these really mobile cores. But the problem is, you're not really able to get in position when there's Beastmaster Vision all the time. Like, Zai is the one who usually receives these ganks because he's off on his own, you know, trying to create his own space and push the waves. But most of the time, if Universe is with the team and they're just kind of grouped up and pushing down a lane, you don't have the best response to that. The best thing you can do, I guess, is have Ember there to slide a fist spam once he has Battle Fury. But otherwise, you really want to fight before EG get to your base.
And Zai has definitely been making a lot of space for his team in this game so far. Aloha Dance, man. He is stalking Fear here. They make their move, jump in, lasso connection, pull back into the right click into the pack. Can they burst him down in time? He's going to get the Blade Fury off, and he's going to make it back into base here. Even a False Promise just to secure his safety on this one. Friends are not going to be able to get their hit and run this time. EG, their posse, moves in. The heal from the ward gets Fear easily back to full with that False Promise, and EG are ready to go in for round number two.
Yeah, this is where they have to back off. I mean, they don't even have reload, so always on the fly could be in a bit
don't
of trouble
do
here.
This. Wee. Makes nice it back there. To the creep, so he's fine.
But again, this is the problem. Like, Friends realize that taking an engagement without being able to get a lasso or when EG are grouped up together is very, very difficult because Aloha Dance isn't quite to the farm level that he needs to be able to 5 versus 5. Or, you know, even 1v5 or whatever you want to call it, because yesterday that was pretty much the case. But he needs like one or two more items, and I don't think EG want to give him that space.
Did Sumail finish his Aghanim Scepter?
He's definitely making it.
He's definitely making it now.
First time I've ever seen an Aghanim's Oracle in a competitive game.
Yep. I mean, part of your brain just thinks like, are EG just doing this because they're EG and they can't do this? Like, I'm just a noob.
If you think about it,
you know, I want to see the value in it.
You know, Oracle is one of those heroes where I feel like it has an insanely high skill cap.
Yeah.
And Sumail is a very, very good player.
Yep, this is true.
So of all the people I would say on the team that would be able to make use of Oracle's skill set the best, it would probably be him. But
where has he been practicing it? You know, I guess it's a strength only thing.
Know.
Yeah, I don't see him playing it in pubs, so it's just something that's where it feels like it's very sporadic to him. But nonetheless, Amanta, the step back, always want to fly under the gun right now, gets the Shellgrave to save, and Disruption will fly out. In the meantime, and Sumail will get bursted down. It's a 1-1 split right now. Aloha Dance re-engages, gets the Pounce connection. They're going to be able to finish off Fear. It looks like a promising fight for Friends on this one, as they now make their target Zai. They'll take him out. Aloha Dance suddenly with a double kill here. And they're not done yet. Looks like PPD is going to be one of the trailing supports. He'll also be going down. It's a triple for the Slark. And Universe, the lone survivor, makes it back into the safety of his base.
And they were so out of position for that fight. Like, Fear was already forced to spin, didn't drop his healing ward, and they False Promise him at the very beginning of the fight just to keep him alive. And in those situations, the defensive plays are really only delaying the inevitable because the Slark at that point hadn't really expended anything. Like, he still had Shadow Dance up. They didn't even get the lasso onto Fear because he popped his Manta like right before the lasso was actually going to go on him. So instead of going for the Jug, who was already pretty much guaranteed to be dead, he just went for the next target instead. And honestly, I think it would have been better for EG if he had just received the lasso, because then at least they're burning a lot of stuff on one hero.
Yeah.
And then you don't have to worry about the lasso after the fact. So not the best fight for EG, unfortunately, being there at the Ancients and getting picked off. But that, again, that's the kind of fights that Friends want. They want to catch EG off guard.
Yeah. What stops Friends from, like, because it seems like the only heavy hitter then is really Fear. I mean, does it mean that they could just build up something? It's not normal for a Slark to build up a BKB, let's say, but if they could just kind of phase out the Timber, then you only have Fear to deal with.
I don't even think he needs BKB, to be honest. That would be a super safe choice. Like, he definitely would never die if he had BKB, there's no question. But I don't know if he even feels that it's necessary, unless he's super scared of, like, Beastmaster or something, or book, like, mana burning or whatever, because that can actually be pretty frustrating as a Slark.
Yeah, because otherwise it seems like it's really just Fear who's the hard hitter for EG right now.
And this is kind of the same issue that we saw the other day as well. When you have a Juggernaut and a Shadow Demon, is if the Juggernaut's not constantly ahead, then the illusions just don't really feel scary because first off, they're not ranged. And second off, if your Juggernaut doesn't have like an insane amount of net worth, the illusions aren't really doing much.
Yeah.
So.
Well, EG are going to find a bit of recovery here as they make their move into the Roche pit. It seems like it will be uncontested as Friends find more value in pushing in this top lane and approaching the tier 3. Looks like Zai will be
first on the scene to help out. Roche will end up going down. His fear will pocket that Aegis in the extra life. And we'll have to see, for the sake of EG, if they're planning on using this to kind of stall things out and level the playing field a bit. But, you know, as you know, Friends would like to see it, they're looking to restrict the amount of farm in the and restrict the map, I'd imagine, away from EG.
Yeah, the slower the game is, the better it is for Friends, honestly. Mm-hmm. So when they're splitting up the map and they're making EG, like, make all these rotations, TPing back to their base and whatnot to defend, that is the ideal situation, because the Slark is going to scale better than anything on EG's team, and they have very limited ways of killing the Slark in general. So it is actually the identical situation that it was when they were playing against Cole, is eventually the Slark's going to get to a point where he can't be stopped,
yeah,
and he's just going to destroy everyone. And the other thing too that's concerning is, you know, Sumail's net worth has been pretty much the same for the past 8 to 10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay, Roar is out.
He doesn't have Hook.
But,
he's not
relocate. They save him.
It wasn't even necessary. Like, Universe's book was on cooldown, so they wouldn't have killed him either way. But now they might actually lose their IO, when in reality he probably could have gotten both of them away had he not relocated. I mean, how could he know that, right?
But, yeah.
Okay, he's still fine.
He's still good. They got a Dazzle nearby. He'll tether his way out.
Zai
get in of it. Meanwhile, Zai top lane not going to be so fortunate. No relocate for him or anything. He just has to off himself, as he will suicide. Head back to the base. EG will split the pressure by making a move down here in the bottom lane, but
yeah. They might have to back though, because Aloha Dance can just hit the building.
Yeah.
And that's not good.
He's got Echo Saber and everything, and a pretty mean right click to kind of do some work. Looks like Fear will be the one to kind of pull off. But back on the note, you know, when you're talking about Sumail, and if this is, you know, where he stands with his net worth, then you begin to apply that he's just kind of plateaued now, and
yeah,
we don't see a new rise of the Oracle from here on forward. Second wind.
I kind of feel like EG wanted to successfully have taken Arax already.
Yeah.
I mean, sure, having the book 3 on Universe, he got a little bit after they were pushing in bottom, so his power spike is fairly large right now. But it's still one of those situations where Friends are just going to keep splitting up the map as best they can, and there's going to come a point where EG aren't given the opportunity to take the fights they want anymore.
Well, at least we're going to get to see an Agnum's Oracle very soon.
I mean,
that's the trump card. Maybe EG have found something about this purifying flames. I mean, it's thousands of gold.
Technically,
for that second.
It's an insane damage output. Right, because you're nuking for, what is it, 360, 390?
Yeah. And you don't look at an Oracle as like a big threat, so he could just be sitting there.
Yeah, it's 390.
Knocking off Purifying Flames over.
Right. Oh, sorry, the heal's 390, the damage 360.
Yeah, over and over and over again. We'll just knock him down with that, but I don't know. I don't know. We'll have to wait and see here. 500 gold before we'll get the finish on that X, but EG are not looking to wait around for it. They recognize that for the lineup overall, they should be the team that's up and ahead right now. As you mentioned, should be possibly even taking down Arax already, so they're going to have to keep putting the pedal to the metal, and they're not looking to wait around for too much extra farm, because Friends will just escalate that much further and be that much more of a problem.
Yeah, I mean, they definitely still push faster than Friends, which is a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
So you can abuse, like, the Disruption Illusions and...
Of course, the Beastmaster helps with that a lot. They're already inside the base now. See how much work they can do. They'd already taken out that Tier 3 in the bottom lane. Here they're at top, already about halfway down. And,
Wait, what? Yoku... He forced that something. I'm so confused.
Yeah, Yoku was in there and then forced himself away. But didn't want to pull the trigger on the lasso, maybe trying to mind game EG a bit. I'll give him the benefit on that. But EG not leaving. Not yet, at least.
It's okay, though, because they saw that they pulled back the Slark, at least, and the Ember Spirit as well. So as long as those two heroes are sitting in base and they're pushing, it's fine. They can stay here.
Here comes an army of Jugs, though, from that disruption. Fear's already in the mix, and it looks like he's happy to just put his life on the line, even if it means his Aegis. Just to get that tier 3. It looks like he will live and move on, but there's been a kidnapping.
Nice,
nice quick reaction with the false promise there. Will save PPD.
That's why you put Sumail on, because his reactions are insane. I mean, did they have a hawk there? They must have, because that was like a very fast reaction.
Oh! Roar, as they will get the catch and the burst, finishing off the dazzle here. GG. Stay strong and move on forward with some advantage in numbers. They feel like they can finish
ball.
The job they win. Hi, how's it going? You always say he's dead, but he finds a way out.
He's dead.
But this time he will die. Yeah. Tether's far, but not far enough. As he can't make it all the way inside the base, that's two supports down from Friends. EG, their siege continues here. More disruption illusions flying out. or the Jug. As he makes his move in, it's two male. He just keeps on healing up his team here, and as you mentioned, no more Aegis. EG, posture up and away, and oh god, Oracle needing a lot of damage there. He gets his Ags finally complete. It's time. It's time. This is it. This is what EG been saving for. The Ags Oracle. This is it.
The Ember might be forced to... actually, they might be okay with giving up one Rex. Depends on how confident they feel taking the fight if Ember were to buy back.
I mean, he's gonna just keep... with Aether Lens, just on the low ground, keep healing him. False Promise. Oh, he gets pulled right back though. They waited on the lasso. No, he's got so many. He's got so many purifying flames. Fear could be fine. He's fine. He's alive.
Oh my god! What a hero. Aghanim's OP.
Yep. And he's dead.
Well, he got the range Rex.
Yep. That's one thing. EG have been here a long time though, just to come in and finally get this range Rex.
I feel like he needs like an AC or something. He needs some armor against the Ember and the Slark.
Yeah.
And there's a dazzle too, so it's like it's really tough. Look at that damage, dude. Damage.
Hmm. It's all that nuke power coming out from the Oracle here.
Yeah. I mean, Ember's obviously always going to have an inflated damage number when the enemy team is 5-manning with creeps down your lane.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, there's the Slark, Scotty. That's what I like to see.
Yeah.
It's just a very easy game to itemize because if you don't need to build a BKB, you can just play it as greedy as you want. And Slark with the Scotty is like one of the best things in the world because even if the Juggernaut spins or whatever.
Ooh.
Oh,
he was spotted. Sumail dished out a quick right click and he knows the jig was up, moves right in. They're going to quickly slash down the Oracle. Universe forced to commit the roar here, will lose his own life, but things are not looking so good for the boys in blue as they are going to be wrecked. They lose three. Friends, make it four now. And they're on a hot pace to take game number one at this rate because things are not going to be getting any easier for EG. The window may have been missed. It's now closed up and padlocked.
I'm kind of wondering, like, the Timbersaw for me doesn't feel like it really fit into the lineup that much because the rest of the heroes kind of want to be together. But Friends have such good pickoff with, like, the Ember Spirit, the Slark, obviously, and the Batrider that most of the time the Timber wants to be somewhere else farming creeps and shoving waves, but he just dies so much when he does that against this team. And if EG are always playing like this 4v5 just because of the mobility of Friends and they can be at the tower to defend every single time at the drop of a hat, it just feels like a very hard game to play Timber.
And now we have Friends making their approach to the top lane. This tier 3 still standing.
I don't know if they don't feel any emphasis, like, they're not pressured right now. Like, Roshan is obviously going to be on the table for them, maybe at least stopping EG. But going high ground right now when you don't need to, and you know that your team scales better, and you have obviously a lot more ways of taking fights and better initiation.
Yeah, but they're full Devi.
Nah, dude.
This is Friends. They don't have
it's
a leader.
You know what's going to happen? It's going to be one of those tournaments where, you know, G had the interview and he's like, yeah, we're just kind of playing. And they're just going to beat everyone.
I know, that's what I was saying to them. It's like, yeah, what we need to do is we need to make sure after every win, we keep interviewing just G so we can see his emotions just like ride like a roller coaster.
I love watching his interviews because he always looks exactly the same. Like, he could have won $10 million and he would look the same.
It's just like, yeah, we
it's like,
did
you know,
it.
We
did it.
We killed some heroes.
We will, they're a good team.
We know, we don't have a captain, but
we'll do it.
We're going to win.
We'll play Dota.
Nah, he is actually amazing.
Yeah, we acknowledge how much each of these players have such a strong individual talent with the game.
Yep.
And, you know, you may not have a leader or an org over your shoulder, but if you put together a good draft, you give each of these talented players a good piece in the game, and that's where they flourish. And EG, who's a team who's obviously still, you know, getting back into the groove of what they had with like their old roster. They're learning the ways of this new meta that they have unfortunately not been able to participate in any of these tournaments. You know, we've only seen them since qualifiers, and since then it's been all scrim games for them. You know, this is their best chance to try out some things, you know, and
is it really
practice
the
up
time,
a bit before TI.
Is it really the time to pull out the Oracle mid though?
I don't know. I mean, better now than TI, I guess.
Yeah.
Didn't they pull out one time like a mid lane Sumail Pugna too?
Yeah, and they got wrecked.
Kind of
like,
feels a little bit like that.
It wasn't as bad as the Pugna, because the Pugna game, there were two roaming heroes and Sumail just got like camped the entire game. And he actually just did nothing. But this game, obviously he had an okay start and then he got his Aghanims maybe a little bit later than he wanted it, but it's the hero limitation now. It's not about the player, it's just you're playing an Oracle and you're going into a late game stage against a Slark and an Ember Spirit. You're going to be having a bad time.
They're just kind of setting that note for all teams watching that's like, hey, you go against us in the future and we pick an Oracle, you're not going to know if it's going to be mid or support. So
it's the mind game.
So don't ban a Sumail hero when we pick Oracle.
Yeah.
It's a mind game tactic.
Scan's going to be used here. That Roshan is super important for EG. If they don't get it, I do not see how they go high ground ever.
EG is a team that can recognize what it is they need to do in a game. And usually what ends up happening is we need to get out there and we need to make a fight happen. And when the fight doesn't work out, they just know it didn't, the game's over. They could even just GG after that one moment, where other teams are like, well, there might be another chance. We'll just continue to hold. EG recognize it's like, if we got to go, we go now. They go. And if it works out, they stay in the game. If it doesn't work out, they might just quit.
It's not dying fast enough. Maybe friends can get here in time. We'll have to see.
Uh-oh. Aloha Dance is hanging around. He sees the poison wave, but he actually heads for PPD instead of into the pit, which means enough time for Fear to be able to finish off the Roche and grab the Aegis. Aloha Dance continues his pursuit. PPD's going to be able to help out with a disruption here, but Universe is going to be going down. That's a gem on the deck and could be picked up quickly. False Promise going to be committed for PPD to keep him alive here, but he's already getting Swarm here, but the rest of EG looking to fight strong. Big Chakram damage coming out from Zai, but Sumail from the outskirts continues to dish off these purifying flames, and it's actually doing a decent number. See, right then and there, Batright, you're in a bit of trouble, but now the Ember is here. He dishes out the Sleight of Fist work, and they're going to be able to get the finish on Sumail. Zai's going to be next to go down, makes it a 4-for-2 split, another huge fight for friends.
Can't take prolonged fights against Slark when you don't kill him right away. I mean, Aloha Dance is just playing this hero so freaking well. Fear is gonna die twice. He doesn't have Blink Dagger. He's just dead.
Okay, buy back on Zai. Fear is dead again.
Yeah, they're gonna have to buy back no matter what because they're gonna need to defend bottom, but I think the game is just done.
If VG use all their buybacks here and don't get a lot out of it, yeah, this could be the towel thrown in and friends could be walking away. What many will consider an upset as they could lead in with a hot game number one of this best of three.
Oh, they're chasing out here. Universe lost his gem though. Oh,
okay.
God.
They just flipped right on him on the high ground there.
They are
Universe,
not
Universe just ran into a brick wall right there.
This is...
Rest of EG are also going to be feeling the repercussions of that huge impact. Sumail will be able to stay alive, giving us off the False Promise, but the slashes keep coming out from G, and that will lead to Sumail's pop. He goes down. And shortly to follow, it does look like Fear will be able to get the slash on the Nope here, taking out the Dazzle. Aloha Dance committing back in, we'll take the PPD. And
they're already dead.
Pullback, and it is over! EG drop game number one. Friends and the power of friendship will do it here, and they pull out the first game victory.
It's a really solid performance from Friends. Obviously, EG were running something a little bit
different.
A little bit less than normal. The mid-Oracle did not quite work out the way I think they wanted it to at the very least, and they were on a timer for sure. They needed to end the game a lot faster than they did, and you could see the emphasis on them like pushing high ground, killing the tier 3 as soon as they could, and you know, trying to get at least a set of racks, because when you have one, then it's a lot easier to 5-man down other lanes, because one lane's